Fingers crossed, hoping that it is jungle Shen right now, because none of the other ones look like good jungle options. I can't actually believe it. I get to guess a jungle Shen
game. You get to do it, man. Return of the jungle Shen. Those who have played League of Legends for many a year may remember references from back in the day to the fabled, the legendary, the mythic River Shen. But this time around, he possesses the entire jungle. This is what TSM are putting their faith in. When the entire series is on the line, they're putting their eggs in the jungle Shen basket. Okay. They must have faith in this. Explain it to us, Kobe.
Let me quickly say what I hope for. So I've tested a lot, Halo Blades and Press the Attack, because you don't want to go grass. That's generally the best one for top lane Shen, but you can't do that in jungle. So Press the Attack, in my opinion, is better, because while you have a little bit less solo pressure, you do have the expose extra damage for your teammates. So I'm hoping that he goes with Press the Attack, and then you can go, you know, the cheap shot and red tree for your secondaries, and you can still get either the cooldown reduction or the extra health, because you have a lot of ability damage. So the Ravenous Hunter also is pretty comparable to the ult reduction red one, but your Cinder Hulk is actually pretty big. Since they buff that, it helps his clearing a lot. Shen has percentage health damage, magic damage on the Q that make his jungling just fine. People really underestimate the clear on this champion. It's not insane, but it is just fine. And a big part of that, the dueling, is of course landing the taunt pass-through Q in on your opponent, and the pass-through Q gives you extra attack speed to proc your Press the Attack. Yes, he did it. Let's go, Spica.
All right, Press the Attack, jungle Shen. Here, the jungle choice for TSM in this game four. Looking at everything else, things seem pretty par for the course. No other big surprises. Jensen was spamming emotes before we even got to 30 seconds into the game, so he seems to be in high spirits after his two monstrous performances in games two and three. Oh, I hope we get a spicy game number four, Kobe.
All right, let me check. He went Ultimate Hunter. So you do have the extra cooldown reduction on your ultimate, and you can stack it up, obviously, by getting the kills on people for more throughout the game. Let's see the jungle route, because Shen does not do AoE camps well at all early on. He can do them, but he's extremely slow at them. So I actually like to create early action with the champion. I think he's an underestimated duelist, especially since he got those buffs to the shield with the extra 20 damage for the passive for his shield. And that's what he's doing. He's skipping those red side AoE camps. He just goes red buff up into top side. This can be extra pressure here towards impact, or even making a pass towards the mid lane. He can also control Scuttlecrab really easily. You can threaten with your taunt, use it early on to quickly take down that, especially considering you do have a Jace topside, which will be pushing.
You heard the man here. I know some of y'all are going to be going into your solo queue games as soon as this game is over, playing some jungle Shen for yourselves. Just remember, he's a vegetarian, and you ain't eating any of them chicken camps. It's just not the right choice.
The chickens actually beat your ass. It's really rough early on.
Until you got the Cinder Hulk, you are a vegetarian. No chicken in the diet. Spica does have both of the buffs completed. He's got the Gromp as well. Hawkshot placed there from Tactical, keeping eyes on him, keeping track of him. They know that he's probably going to be in that area because he doesn't want to clear those AoE camps on the red side. They know where he's at, and Brox is going to keep farming up too.
Okay, so he can do it now that he's level 3. And in pro play, you have a lot less options for creating those early ganks. It is just that it is going to be slow. Lilia will have a power clear. Once you're level 3, you can get your Spirit's Refuge to dodge zone, block a lot of the damage. But you see, even then, he still has to use Smite on it. Invade here for Tactical actually goes for the super deep ward. Trying to figure out what's going on with this jungle Shen.
Yeah, where's he at?
I need to figure it out. Haven't been able to predict it. Lilia should be power clearing right down to the Scuttlecrab, though, as we see Spica going for top side one, because it's always safe to go. Your Jace lane should guarantee you your Scuttlecrab of choice on the top side, so you don't have to fight over it with Lilia. Lilia should be able to have priority there.
Yeah, Lilia versus Shen, all you have to do is make sure you're hitting those spells and you can just kite him around in a circle over and over again. Aside from the taunt, he doesn't really have anything to try to stick to the Lilia, keep her in one spot. So trade of crabs there as both of our junglers sitting on 24 CS. Spica does go back to base first to pick up the Stalker's Blade, give him some extra gank power there with the Chilling Smite, makes it easier to hit the taunt afterwards. Broxah decides to stay out on the map, continue power farming up.
Okay, so we can move on from the Jungle Shen, as exciting as it is.
Okay.
He's going to look for his level 6. You should not underestimate flash plays with Shen, because Taunt Flash works really well coming from the jungle, especially for lanes that do have setup. But we can focus on the rest of it right now. Biofrost and Double Lift on bottom side. You see them trying to get some priority for themselves, using their Targon stacks, pushing in. Meanwhile, Broken Blade does have to be a little bit worried of the Lilia coming in as he's next to the wall right now, and in fact going to try and set up.
Let's see if they can make this 2v1 on Broken Blade, get at least a flash. Doesn't look like it. Swirl Seed hits on the back end of the fight, but considering there's no ulti for Broxah, that means no sleep to follow it is not much of a threat at all onto the Jace. So
yeah.
TL try to go for a move, and Broken Blade just walks away.
Little bit of extra damage. This is another one of the reasons why you take phase rush a lot on Jace top, even though you're against a tank and you're like, okay, you know, in a secure 1v1, nobody else involved, Conqueror is great, but Jace benefits so much from phase rush. It's crazy. Since you're always pushing, you're always looking for lane advantages, knowing that you have phase rush to be able to pop whenever you get ganked, especially against a Lilia that relies on slows, and your phase rush, and you just shrug them off. You see him just go in, he queues to proc it, he's able to walk his way out, no problem, going for the early trade, and allowing the Shen to just continue to farm up, look for the level 6, where they can try and pull off a Stand United plus Rakan play. Those can be super devastating. Bottom side even going for early trades.
Yep. Speaking of Rakan plays, Biofrost making sure that he starts off a little bit of a 2v2 down here. Tactical and Core JJ are at a health disadvantage. Both mid laners have used their teleports to go back to base, complete those first purchases. You can see in Jensen's inventory paying a lot of respect towards Bjergsen Syndra with that null magic mantle being the first item in the inventory besides starter items. So wants to make sure he's got a bit more resistance to the all-in power of the Syndra. Also having the Dark Seal and Corrupting Potion together for extra healing and sustain in that lane. Bjergsen, of course, moving towards the tier so we can get that Archangels and eventually Seraph's Embrace that is so very powerful on Syndra, as the third Scuttle Crab of the game will spawn in the bottom side river. That is controlled by TL, so they will easily make sure Broxah can get that one and put more farm in his pocket here on the Lilia, still working towards that level 6 as all 4 solo laners have hit that mark already.
Yeah, and Lilia is in every world going to outfarm a Jungle Shen here. So Broxah yoinks the raptors away, clears off his blue side and starts up the dragon as there is a recall timer from TSM's bottom lane, and TSM just kind of accepting an early deficit here in the matchup. Dragon should go over to Team Liquid without too much further effort. Checking in on that mid lane matchup, because we talked about Jensen being one of the only other mid laners that are acceptable for playing the early Zillion. He is at a CS disadvantage early on, being it very difficult to actually hit the CS for Zillion in the
right
early stages while your bombs are kind of weak. But he's holding up pretty well considering he is against the Syndra here from Bjergsen. And meanwhile, we're going to still keep our eyes on the level 6 for the Shen. Broxah has the early level 6 on Lilia due to out-farming and could look to have one of those punish plays where you Swirl Seed set up somebody, one of your opponents, to try and get a kill. Maybe Broken Blade is an option, but honestly, there are no flashes blown already, so no easy targets.
Yep, Impact is still just using that passive to buy himself some free items here in lane, continue having a solid lane presence. Impact is down the same amount of CS versus the Jace that Jensen is versus Bjergsen. So Impact's been doing a really good job against this Jace, making sure that it's not building up incredible advantages against him, scaling up here on this Ornn. We know what this champion looks like once it gets to that level 13 and beyond point where the items are able to come online and you get all that massive extra value. Broxah still working towards the completion of his Runic Echoes here on the Lilia. Remember, most of the time, The Lilia builds you see are Runic Echoes into Liandry's into tankier itemization after that, considering her AP ratios aren't the most impressive. You just go jungle item, and then the power of the Liandry's passive burn is super great when stacked with her already DOT-based passive. So I'll keep an eye on Brox's itemization as we continue forward in this game here.
Yeah, and that's why we're looking for the lanes that can actually set up Broxah, because this is Team Liquid's PowerPoint right now. It is the Lilia matchup. They have to be pretty worried about Stand United coming in at the moment, so overextending could be punished pretty easily. Tactical and Core JJ would be the lane to try and do it now that they both are level 6 and you have access to both forms of CC from them with their ultimates. Like we do.
Or is it not a lane at all? Is it not a lane at all as Bjergsen just yoinks the blue buff away? Syndra is so good at this. I remember, Kobe, back in when Syndra first came out, I played a solo queue game against a guy that did that against me every single play, and now the plays are popping off here in the bottom lane. Double is going to be in some trouble. TL about to make it a double. Biofrost wants to run, but Brox is on the chase. Swirl Seed over the wall. Strike! Give him the bowling ball, baby. TSM ends up getting one back onto Impact in the top half of the map.
Yep, that's the Team Liquid. Ash Arrow and Nautilus Ultimate available. So much crowd control and setup on the bottom side. Blast Cone right over for Broxah means two kills for Team Liquid. Spica sees this, and he just... All right, it's time to leave. I'm out of here, boys. He ult stop for Broken Blade immediately. He just runs away from the fight and goes to make a play on the opposite side of the map. Big one there for TSM to make sure that they don't lose out on this mid-game play unanswered. And them getting the kill so for extra money here, yes, the last hit did go to Shen, which is just going to fund more tanky items, but they also got the Rift Herald they were able to give over. So here's another look. Ash Arrow into Nautilus, gets the hook into the ultimate here, and Broxah jumps over for the Lilia follow-up, easily able to sleep them. Swirl Seed finds its mark as well, but answer play. TSM, top side. Broken Blade finishes up on the ward. And they kind of hit the emergency button, like, okay, how are we going to punish them? Where do we make something off of this bottom lane focus? It's actually Impact who starts it out onto Broken Blade. Even with his team making a play on the bottom side at the same time, you often don't really think about the possibility of a jungle Shen standing up coming through. So that was probably the lapse in judgment there, but he also could have just been... getting ganked at the time. Anyways, turns into top lane kill plus Rift Trail possibility. Turret plates are being traded as Team Liquid pushing on bottom side.
TSM have rotated Biofrost up here to the tier one, summoning up Shelly after taking out the first two plates. This is a common strategy now. Almost everybody has this knowledge of how to properly get the most value out of your Rift Herald summon. The turret will be left alive here with just under one plate's worth of health left to go, and Impact takes his spot back underneath that one, farming up these minions. It's way too reinforced after four plates have died for TSM to try to stick around and take those down even in a 3-1, but they do get the advantage in the plate trading overall. They got one extra plate compared to what TL did, considering they had Rift Herald there.
All right, Dragon about to spawn, so maybe we have a reset. You can already see on the minimap, TSM are doing the reset. They've got bottom lane coming down right through the minion wave for the Dragon setup. And you know, have Dragon setups like this, now. You need to take a breath. Everybody, I'm going to give you a quick meditation lesson. You breathe in, you hold that for 7 seconds, and then you breathe out slowly for 8 seconds. And it doesn't really matter the timing of your seconds. You can just count in your head. What matters is the ratio. Thank you, Captain Flowers, for demonstrating for me. A very good assistant here. But this is something you can use in high-pressure situations like this. Say you find yourself in a clash series, a playoff series in this situation. You can focus a lot better with that. Breathing technique's really underrated.
Yeah, I appreciate that. We'll go ahead and make sure we give you guys an update as soon as I have one available to me on the state of the pause. But for now, we are left on the edge of our seats with the fact that this dragon is about to spawn. The teams are so very evenly matched here in this game. For honestly, Kobe, this is what I want to see as we get further and further into a series. I love the series where the games just get closer and closer as you go. The worst thing is when you get to five games, then game number five is a blowout. This is what I love seeing, the epic buildup to the crazier and crazier games.
End strong. That's what the coaches always tell you. You got to finish strong here, okay? TSM are down. They're facing match point here. Team Liquid already got it in their eyes. They're looking to return to finals. Let's get right back into the game, though. We have gameplay. Gold dead even though the extra kill did go over to Team Liquid. You mentioned the extra plate for TSM.
All right, let's see where we're at. Back in the game now. 20.1 to 20.3. TSM have Speaka in the river. Broken Blade coming around from the side here as well. CoreJJ going to be in some trouble. Drops the aggro there with a stopwatch, but TSM is a watching and a waiting. Broken Blade's out of the picture. And Team Liquid have the first kill of the fight. Health bars are in dire shape. And over the wall comes the damage on to two. TSM making the plays happen. But Jensen is lobbing some bombs in there, and that one nearly takes out Bjergsen. More damage will continue flying, but Team Liquid is backing themselves away. Double bomb's not going to find a stun onto Speaka. It's a one fight for TSM so far.
And critically, Team Liquid lose their jungler. No smite for them. So even if they win this, they won't get an objective. They want kills, though. Jensen, he smells blood.
Jensen still looking to get more out of this. He arrived to the fight late. He wants to have some sort of impact in this fight. But speaking of impact, he's in trouble. Broken Blade TPing back in after his initial death, looking to set up the plays here for TSM onto the TL top laner. Jensen runs away. No point in sticking around to try to cast that chrono shift onto his ally. And that's even more dubs here for TSM in the bottom side river early on. They'll take the Scuttle Crab. They'll move back onto the Drake. Still five men strong. TL will try to challenge, but they are in a 4v5 here for 15 seconds. Nice stun over the wall from Bjergsen. Nice collapse from the rest of TSM. Nice ulti from Jensen bringing somebody back alive, but you only get one. And TSM take two. Tactical and CoreJJ are down.
Speaker gets the dragon, and he gets the taunt flash from the Shen inside the pit. Locks down another one. TSM double teleport, Captain Flowers. Team Liquid, this is why you pay so close attention to tracking summoner spell cooldowns. The double teleport from TSM comes in, they pull off the bait. Everybody was waiting around there out in the middle of bottom lane, hoping to bait Team Liquid in. Even though TSM didn't have vision, they knew they were looking around for a possibility to punish, and they do. So, it's Bjergsen teleport in lane with them, and Broken Blade teleports up to this ward you see on your screen now for the pincer movement, and they take out Impact. No more frontline for Team Liquid, means they can start up the dragon, they get the Scuttle Crab for extra movement speed and vision for themselves. And then, here we go. Dragon taken, stun from Bjergsen was the one to set it up. This man, Syndra, has just been outstanding. The stun's coming through from these angles. He hits him over the wall, allowing Speaka that follow-up for the taunt and flash.
Well played from TSM, building themselves up a nice 2,000 gold advantage here 15 minutes in. Look at Double Lift, 5-1-0 here on the Senna. Has both the Mana Moon and Edge of Night completed. Bought the Edge of Night right after that last team fight where he got so much money. He is in a fantastic position heading into this mid-game.
How far he's come on this champion, Captain Flowers. Can we give out an award, one of those yearbook
improved?
Awards? Yearbook for most improved on a single champion. Goes to Double Lift from the Team Liquid days of it being a ninth place downfall of the team. Everybody memeing on him for it. To a switch over here to playing against Team Liquid themselves on it.
Making the plays on the Senna, earning his redemption on the champion. Let's see if he can keep it up here moving forward. He will have a lot of heavy lifting to do here for TSM. They need him to help carry this game. Jensen takes some damage there from the stun, but considering the rest of TSM is not in a position to collapse, that means that he can just walk away, not too worried about it. Won't have to use ulti or flash there. Also want to point out that 16 minutes in, Bjergsen does have the Seraph's Embrace fully charged. So not only does he have all the extra mana available from the tier being stacked, but the powerful active shield will help him buy a little bit of extra time in the team fights if he finds himself focused by Team Liquid, who does have 2 kills on their Lilia, so eyes will be on Broxah to see what he can accomplish, if there's any big sleeps that come through. Remember, at any point, if you have Lilia's passive ticking on you from having that spell damage applied, you can be put to sleep with the ulti, even if the swirl seed is thrown all the way down the lane from base. So Broxah will have a lot of playmaking potential as this game goes forward.
See if they can make use of it, because they have to worry about staying united, so even if they get catches, you have to account for an extra cooldown here and not overcommit. Thankfully for them, Lilia is one of the best champions at not overcommitting, because she can stack up her move speed, and then as soon as you see stand united, it's an easy walk away from that one, and you try and bait out cooldowns that way. But this is going to be the push and pull. TSM want to use their extra global with the Shen ultimate to try and make those plays on Team Liquid. Meanwhile, from the Team Liquid perspective, you always want to get a lot out of the Zillion mid game, because that is where the revive is really, really annoying for Jensen, being able to turn around a lot of these fights. You think you've killed Ornn, you think you've killed the frontline or something, you have to do it all over again.
Nice stun there from Jensen. It was an attempted follow-up with the swirl seed from Broxah, but Jensen couldn't close the distance enough to get the double bomb stun, so Spica could not be caught. Rift Herald is down, nearly killed away. Biofrost going in, Stand United on top of him. Broxah's going to be in some trouble. Two-man taunt from Spica. There comes your Dawning Shadow. There goes Tactical. And Spica makes sure he gets the kill. 3,000 gold lead for TSM, 5v4 on the map for TSM. TL, they may have managed to get the Herald, but the Eye is still back in the pit. They won't be able to pick it up.
Zaya's got nothing on Shen. The one true pairing actually is Shen and Rakan. Biofrost and Spica make it in there. Into the back line, they get the double off. The CC layering is insane, plus the extra shield for Rakan goes so far with the survivability. You can see Biofrost, no fear. As soon as he knows Spica's there for the backpack, immediately uses everything to close the distance, setting them up for this dragon. Team Liquid, though, they've revived. This is their chance to have something to say about the dragon stacking, because Bjergsen is top lane right now. He'll have to teleport into the fight.
Drake will be Ocean Soul again. 3 out of 4 games in this series so far have been an Ocean Soul. It's 1-to-1 for both sides, so nobody's posing that big threat just yet. Broxah loses half his HP there from a quick trade out of TSM. Lilia, very much not a tanky champion. If you catch her out of position at all, it's going to hurt. Drake pulled out here by the bomb. TL looking to continue to contest TSM around this one, but TSM do have a very formidable gold lead, over 4,000 at this point in the game. TL have to make the call if this is worth fighting for or not. Swirl Seed still going out, only finding their way onto one. Impact with the ulti, the damage coming through, the damage pouring down. Double if dominating, able to grab the kill into Core JJ. Bjergsen falls 1-for-1. It is support for mid laner. MVP candidate for MVP traded off. TSM still with very high health bars. Brox is at 1/3. He has got to be so careful with Spica coming around the back end of this fight towards TL. Do they still want to stick around? Do they still want to challenge? It's Broxah that's got to go into range and try to smite fight this. And TSM are immediately going in. They're immediately turning things back onto TL. They bait Team Liquid into sticking around too long, and then they take the fight. With the kill on the Tactical, they'll grab the Drake anyway. And TL was biting off way more than they could chew.
They are waiting on the cooldown for Shen and Rakan ultimates again, Captain Flowers. That's why they stuck around so long. And once they get the opening here, Biofrost again goes for the initiation. Split second play, and TSM get the team fight. They get the dragon. Team Liquid are trying to get some scraps off of the map afterwards, but that is another big play from TSM that looks like they're making a good case for a game number 5 for some silver scrapes. Let's get into the replay, though. On to performance replay will give us a better idea. This is a good play by Team Liquid. They know that Rakan ultimate and Shen Stand United should still be down, so they try and hard force while they aren't available. It's just unfortunate for Team Liquid that they actually lose Core JJ's life in their all-in there. Nautilus players are accustomed to being on the front line and going down first for these, but you have to be a little bit more tricky with that play. They are unable to keep Core JJ alive while they're taking down Bjergsen, and that allowed the rebuttal from TSM afterwards.
TSM still with that 4,000 gold lead. You can see the item completion. Muramana fully evolved now for Doublelift. Has Rapid Fire Cannon too for the extra range on the auto attacks. Can help set up the rest of the team there with the Glacial Augment. Locket of the Iron Solari for Spica now coming together as well to provide additional protection in these team fights as TL tries to initiate onto them. Impact trading aggressively here against Broken Blade. The Ornn is now level 13. Massive power spike for this champion. Biggest one in the game as he manages to get both the Sunfire Cape and Abyssal Mask upgraded.
I love this from Spica because in solo queue, admittedly, I go Titanic Hydra for my Jungle Shen, but that is because it's solo queue and you need
right.
to carry.
It's a different
because
game.
Even though I'm playing a team-focused champion, you really can't count on these people, right?
Right, yeah. You,
but
you met him 3 minutes ago in the lobby.
In pro play, though, you got to go full tank. Jungle is inherently lower income than top lane, than solo lane there. So you don't really have the extra time and money to invest in going for that. And it's much better to go full support, full tank here. Locket scales with health, so he gets really high value out of it. Plus, the resistances are great to have on top of the Cinder Hulk.
Whoa! Nice full retreat from Doublelift, keeping himself safe here as Team Liquid's still going to be in the fight, but now they're having to run away. Impact with a good ulti on to two. Damage down to Broken Blade. There you go. First kill of the fight over to Team Liquid, but now they're going to be in some trouble. Jensen ulti placed down into Core JJ, bringing him back a life. Nice CC from Spica. Once again, trying to seal his fate. Some bombs over the wall will not secure any kills, but they will make sure TL is able to walk away from this one with a 1-0.
Yeah, good ult there by Jensen. They're able to get him out this time. No casualties for Team Liquid. And they should be able to even clear these minion waves. Honestly, it's TSM are still attempting to push, but there's so much wave clear here. You've got bombs coming out. Swirl Seeds should come down. Yeah, you actually can't push on that afterwards. Team Liquid come out of it with a pretty big victory there, getting their kill onto Broken Blade, getting some gold to try and fund their comeback efforts.
Big item completion after that for Core JJ as well. Getting the Gargoyle Stone Plate makes it much easier for him to engage without the threat of being instantly deleted as soon as he uses that first rotation of spells. Jensen did a good job keeping him alive in this last team fight, but let's be honest, if we're looking at win conditions for Team Liquid, Jensen needs to be able to save that ultimate for a more valuable target than support Nautilus, and this item should help that goal be accomplished.
Now, for Team Liquid to make this comeback a reality, they're going to need to collect this bounty on Doublelift's head. Maybe we have an extended exchange here, but Doublelift is holding a large bounty on top of Senna right now. So no flash, they should have that flash timer, should make him a target. It gets a little bit more dicey since he's gotten the spell shield from the Edge of Night, and right. He's got a lot of extra range right now. Didn't see the last check-in on the Senna stacks, but thankfully we have the new graphic pop-up every about 7 minutes. They will let us know. You can already see the extended range taking effect for him, though. And this will be the moment. Can Team Liquid actually find the engagement back there to cash in, get that big bounty, and stabilize in this match?
Yeah, people are quick to criticize Doublelift when he makes a misplay, when he gets too greedy and overstays or oversteps, but he's been doing a very good job this game, making sure that he's not getting himself into those precarious situations, making sure that he's paying respect towards his opponents and retreating properly. Now, Team Liquid going in. Core JJ tries to go for the flash hook, but when he misses the hook, it's up to the rest of the team to go after Bjergsen. The damage keeps on coming through. The bomb's going to hurt him here a little bit, but plenty of shields keep Bjergsen alive. That missed hook from Core JJ means this is still not enough just yet. Bjergsen so low. Bjergsen taken down. Jensen making sure it's not a one-for-one just yet. Biofrost jumping back into the fight, but he's going to be down to 200 HP now as well. Core JJ walking back, bomb on his head. Nobody else going to chase him out. Team Liquid will once again take a 1-0. Very importantly this time, it is a power player on TSM that's the man in the dirt. And that means TL feel confident enough to start off this Drake. Broxah is very low. That must be in the minds of these Team Liquid players. They have to pay respect to TSM. Spica's in the pit. Spica's looking to make the steal. Broxah after the Drake. He's able to secure it. Spica still down here in this pit. Can dash over the wall with the taunt. He will not be caught out. Team Liquid making the choice to run away. Shock Blast won't do a thing. And that will be another encounter going the way of TL. The pick onto Bjergsen. It took a lot, but they got it.
You can say that again, Flowers. It took so much. Steve must have put out a contract on Bjergsen's head that outweighs this giant bounty on Senna. They threw everything on him. He got hit with Flash Ultimate Hooks, Ash Ultimate, Zillion Bombs, Ornn Ultimate, Lilia Sleep. He literally took all of the crowd control that they have in their roster. Look at this. Okay. Take a deep breath. Core JJ, he's first up. All right, they've got a contract on his head. He goes for the flash, misses the hook, still ults him. Then Jensen goes in to get a bomb on his head. Ash arrow stuns him. Ornn ultimate knocks him up. Jensen throws out the super soaker slow on him as well. Bjergsen survives because TSM put out counter pressure, but then Lilia sleep comes through. Another hook goes through. Team Liquid don't give up when they're looking to kill Bjergsen. Resurrection comes through. They save Core JJ's life. In his endeavors to get the contract completed, and they make it complete with the dragon on top. That is critical, denying TSM the soul point.
TSM and Team Liquid evenly matched in terms of Drakes. TSM commanding a 3,000 gold lead, a 9-6 kill advantage, 2-1 turret lead. Ornn items are coming online. However, the Ornn is now the target. Broken Blade in a 1v1. That's not a 1v1 for long. It's Spica coming in with the help of the Stand United and even the Dawning Shadow contributing to make sure they get this kill. Impact is off the map for 40 seconds.
What really can they do with the extra pressure, though? Because they're not actually going to start up Baron in a 4v5 situation where they've only got a 30-second timer since Impact has teleport on Ornn. So they try and push the lanes. Broken Blade can get some damage on this turret. Maybe he actually even gets the turret for his troubles. It is a little bit dangerous.
TL are seen by TSM as they move over to this. They thought they were shooting the arrow from Fog, but in fact, Spica had vision on where they were trying to come around from. And now Jensen trying to fight Broken Blade here. Pops the ulti. Jensen's ult is early. That means Broken Blade does have the ability to try to wait this out and go for the kill. Instead, he's baited in by the stasis, by the flash. Jensen gets away. Bjergsen tries to show up and get the revenge kill, but now Core JJ is going in and Bjergsen's in some trouble. Ulti coming through and the shield is down, but it will not matter. Bjergsen is out of here, and it's a double kill for Brox's Lilia. TSM are 3v5 on the map, and Team Liquid has the punish.
Fancy feat here from Jensen with the immunity, is able to get out on top of it. Even after waiting at the revive timer here from Broken Blade, TSM end up overextending, and now it is Team Liquid with the power play despite the gold deficit. Teleport is available for Broken Blade, though, for TSM. They can actually try and 4v5 this one as soon as he gets back up. They can call for it. Shock Blast will come through. Baron drop it quickly, though.
This is a very important point in the game. Could determine how things go for the next 5 to 10 minutes. TL still sticking on the Baron. TP coming in from Broken Blade. Baron still being just whittled away at, down to 3,000 HP. Accelerated Shock Blast finds the mark. It's probably going to be a smite fight. It's secured by Broxa. Now TL have to decide, do you go for a fight or do you run away? Bjergsen's back alive, but no TP to join up with the rest of the team means he has to go the long way around. It's going to be a nice leisurely hike through Summoner's Rift. Spica sees the enemy red buff, thinking about stealing that one away. Nobody from TL is going to be near this one to try to stop him. They all get themselves out, and they're wearing purple.
Really good Ornn ultimate here from Impact, honestly. Gets the knockup as Spica's trying to walk around the back of the pit to go for a steal. He denies any chance of going for that steal. There was Taunt ready, there was Blast Cone ready, and Flash ready for Spica. So he had a lot of options to get in if you don't CC him outside of the pit during the time where the Baron is low, and they actually time that really well where they execute the Baron during the knockup. Here's another look at Broken Blade trying to 1v1 Jensen, though. He goes in for the phase rush, procs the extra speed, uses that to get away from the slowdown from the Glacial Augment, flashes back in to try and get the execute, but Jensen flashes away from the Spica flash over the wall.
Yep. Brock's
finishing him off means that even Bjergsen has overextended. He tried to go for the stun there to follow up for one extra kill for TSM, but hits with the Swirl Seed, meaning Baron now on Team Liquid, and the Royals are looking for another dragon. 10 seconds, Flowers.
That was so well played by Jensen there, making sure that not only did he bait with the stopwatch, but also not being afraid to use the flash, commit that to guarantee he stays alive. Core JJ, once again, the flash hook, the accuracy not there. from Core JJ. We've seen him make these in the past, but here in this game, it's not working out. Biofrost going in with the quickness. Can he get down with the sickness? Let's see if TSM can pull off the fight. Impact's taking a lot of damage here on the front line, having to flash away. Team Liquid's health bars are hurting, and TSM have a very definitive lead here in this fight so far. TL know that TSM are heading over to the Drake. This is not Soul for either team. TL do not have to fight this. TSM with control over the pit. Health bars are in some trouble. Three-man sleep comes through. Bomb's going to be thrown out. Impact right back into the fight. He's got the Warmog's Broken Blade taken low. Zillion ulti already used. Tactical keeping himself away. Focus fire keeping alive. Getting away now with 200 HP. TSM also having to back up a little bit now. Core JJ has once again entered back into the mix. But it's going to be a dragon secured by Rakan of all people. Biofrost taking TSM to a Soul point. Doublelift running away as Impact is in hot pursuit. Jensen has 3/4 of the cooldown already resolved for his ultimate, but TL will not chase this any further. That is an objective victory for TSM.
And even with the Baron buff here, Tactical actually makes a call. He's out of there, not chasing anyone down, so Team Liquid will get some gold back for themselves. Even with the Dragon going over to TSM, they're trying to make up some of the distance in the gold discrepancy here, but TSM, as you said, now on Soul point. And do they even want to let Team Liquid get out and reset after this one?
Jensen looking for a little bit of damage here onto Spica, but with Doublelift nearby, Jensen's going to be respectful. Here's your initiation. Biofrost going in. Jensen in some trouble. Going to be taken very low. Doublelift damage over the wall. Able to make him proc the ulti. Now Core JJ is the target. Down to 1/3 HP, but Bjergsen is targeted next. Impact looking to maybe use the ram, but it's not going to work out too much here either. Dredgeline not going to find the target. As Broxah goes golden, and Impact goes down. Broken Blade making the kills, but it's also going to be a kill onto Broxah. Coming out from Bjergsen now as Tactical grabs one onto Spica. TL trying to back the remaining three players out of the jungle. It's an even trade, 2-for-2, but TL do not have the health bars to continue.
They just keep swinging, Captain Flowers. What a jungle skirmish there. Two sides of that fight. Right side, Impact getting chased down. Broken Blade and Doublelift able to take him out. Meanwhile, on the other side, though, Team Liquid carries finish off Biofrost and Spica, catching them there with the extra CC. And here's another look at it. You're going to have to kind of split your eyes because there's two different sides of the fight. Doublelift, you see him in the little alcove for the Krugs. Impact comes up behind him while Doublelift procs Jensen's revival, and then he flashes away from Impact, going for the charge. But on the left side, the whole fight with the Drowsy comes through. Bjergsen gets sleep. Broxah gets stummed up. He actually goes into Zhonya's as Spica tries to dive in for the kill. So Spica goes down while Biofrost also gets shot there by Tactical, picking up the extra kills. And both teams split money.
This game is delivering here in game number 4. Last team fight, let's summarize the damage here a little bit. It's all about Broken Blade, it's all about Bjergsen, and for Team Liquid, man, put all the other damage meters together and you're gonna equal something that looks about like what Tactical did. The Ash is doing the work here for this Team Liquid squad, and what a player to do it, man. I talked about how in game number 1, it was Tactical in the Team Liquid series against FlyQuest that made him go to game 5, and even if they ultimately lost that one, he was the one responsible for making it go as long as it did. Broken Blade having to run away now. Impact and Jensen on the hunt. Nice shot coming in from the rookie AD carry right through the heart. Put that man in the grave. Team Liquid find the pick.
Tactical has not been to an LCS Finals yet, and he wants that spot. Able to chase him down. That is another kill for Team Liquid. That means map control. You look at this toggle of vision from the observers. Really nicely done there. You can see how dark it's starting to get for TSM. That gold lead that TSM have held for the majority of this game has
been a long
dwindled
time.
Down to 400.
And remember those Ornn items. Those Ornn items that initially Impact's allies did not have items to enchant. They had no items to upgrade when he first hit level 14. Literally no other player could be upgraded. Now you have the most desired AD carry upgrade, the Molten Edge from the Infinity Edge, completed for Tactical. You have the Zhonya's Hourglass upgraded into the Zhonya's Paradox on Broxah. Still waiting on Jensen to buy something that could be upgraded, but hey, that's all right. 2 out of 3 ain't bad. And when you look at Core JJ, he's still just focusing those active items. The Stone Plate from earlier, now supplemented by the power of the Shirelia's Reverie to speed up the entire team, means Team Liquid has more engage options. Impact is hanging out off to the side, the rest of Team Liquid on the Baron. TSM stepping up. They know they can't just afford to passively give this one away. Biofrost in the front line, tagged with one of the bombs from Jensen, but not two. Core JJ about to get hit by the CC from Doublelift. Goes for the Gargoyle Stoneplate. Now going to be in some trouble. He's killed off. There's no ulti coming in from Jensen here just yet. Speaker's in some trouble. Has to get himself out of here, as now Biofrost is buying a little bit more time. Tactical could just die here, but a good ulti from Jensen to keep him alive. TSM wants to get right back into the fight. They want to get onto the AD carry, and Bjergsen will be the man to send him to the grave. TSM, they lose the Baron, but they take two kills. And what's that, Kobe? Knock, knock. It's Ocean Soul in 10 seconds.
Oh my goodness, TSM fighting for their playoff lives here. They too want their spot back in finals. Last time around, they lost the finals to Team Liquid, but they don't want to lose this one. It's going to be Ocean Soul, baby. And do you see any grievous wounds yet on the Team Liquid side? Immediately, Executioner is actually pushing
up
you right there.
Pick it up.
Tactical is like, okay, I hear you. Ocean Soul picked up. They're going to need to try and cut some healing. What a big play there. And again, some of the differences in these team fights you can see in if TSM are able to land their crowd control on the TL backline. The last time around, in the previous one, TSM only locked up Broxah and Impact, the frontliners here for TL, without damage to capitalize. But this time around, that CC chain that they pulled onto Tactical, Biofrost and Bjergsen, setting that one up, even with a Zillion revive, they take down the Team Liquid carry.
Team Liquid still not in a spot where they can feel comfortable in this game. Even when times are looking tough, TSM are able to rally. 115 stacks on Doublelift's Senna. It's 25 range per 20 stacks. You do the math. That means in five more stacks, he has 150 bonus range. Biofrost going in. Core JJ the target. Team Liquid on the counterattack, but will they be able to find their mark? Speak is going to be taking so much damage here, barely survives and walks away. The same can be said for Tactical. Team Liquid backing themselves up now, trying to make sure they don't overextend, but at the same time, looking for any possible window that might just be slightly cracked open to look for an opportunity.
Yeah, breathe deep once again and try and get some fresh air from that window while you can, because it will be stifling if you do not. You have to fight for every inch of vision here through your own jungle. You can see Broxah now heading down. There's one hit left on this ward that actually never got fully cleared. So they do see him on the pass attempt from Team Liquid, trying to pick people off. And you can continue to just throw out late game swirl seeds. This is what Lilia gameplay turns into. You just constantly fish for possibilities with your swirl seed to set up your capitalization. Ash Arrow, Ornn Ultimate, Nautilus. They can all follow up from very long ranges away if you catch a fish.
So many opportunities here. 65,000 to 65,000 gold. Less than 500 separating your teams at 39 minutes into the game does not mean anything. The Elder alive in 3.5 minutes. The Baron in a little bit over 2.5. It's going to come down to these big objectives, Kobe. It's going to come down to who executes and out-macros their opponents properly around these objectives to set themselves up better for the fight. This is your segment from the beginning of the day, man. It's the team who's more prepared, the team who is able to lie in wait and be ready for the fight. Team Liquid currently lying in wait in this brush on the bottom side of the river here near mid lane, trying to push these waves out and maintain neutral control.
And I will note that one of the drawbacks of full support jungle Shen like Spica's going for is you don't have the options of late game split push, because only your Sindelhulk is AoE damage. You don't push minion waves very quickly. Here we go, though.
They're deciding to go in. The arrow comes out, but it doesn't hit a valuable target. A lot of resources used here from Team Liquid. All of their initiation came out except for the Nautilus ulti in that one. No Lilia ult, no Ornn ult, no Ash ult available. TSM will feel a little bit safer, but the problem is Doublelift did lose some HP. Spica lost some HP. They will be able to heal back up there with those piercing shadows from Doublelift. Ocean Soul, so very powerful, man. That thing just did so much work in these kinds of scenarios. 2 minutes till Elder, 1.5 till Baron. Team Liquid backing back out. You can see Core JJ heading back to base, top off that control ward inventory, recharge the normal Sightstone style item, and make sure that you're ready for this vision battle.
It's going to be an epic one too here, as Baron is approaching in just over 1 minute. They do have Ocean Soul Regeneration, which helps a lot considering you have long-range Senna and Jace for possibilities of poking around before the full engage gets off. But Team Liquid have so many forms of engage. If they just sync it up a tiny bit better than they did in the last time, they'll be able to force the fight. Core JJ's Nautilus was the only one, I believe, to not use the ultimate in the last attempt that they had.
Correct.
They still have to watch their positioning, especially for Tactical, though, because Tactical's job gets very difficult now. All eyes are on him, and you better believe that a Rakan plus Shen combination will be looking for him in the back line. He is the big source of consistent damage. Even though there is a lot of AoE magic damage on the team with Zilean and Lilia, Tactical is the big dealer.
Big item for the Lilia, too. During that last reset, Broxah was able to purchase the Banshee's Veil. So going for a full AP Bruiser itemization type this time around on the Lilia with that Zhonya's and Banshee's combo. That Spell Shield will do well to protect him from both the poke of things like the Jace and the Syndra, as well as some pick potential coming through from initiation from Rakan and things of that nature. Now it's TL once again onto the Baron. They know there's no Elder for TSM to threaten with. The Baron's down to 5k. TL having to make the call. Do you stick onto the Baron? Do you try to go for this? TSM moving in. They're looking to take the fight. Core JJ very low. Blue team's gonna steal the Baron! It's a speak of steal! And TSM are now looking to take the fight. TL are still healthy. TL are still in a decent enough spot, but it's Bjergsen with a three-man stun. TL backing themselves away. Spica with the hero play so far. Double is still looking to move forward. Now going to be falling back, clearing out a couple of wards. Broken Blade firing off a Shock Blast. Won't find a thing. TSM coming up clutch. Pings onto the Elder Drake.
The youngest player in the LCS finds the taunt at the last second into the Baron Pit Flowers, and then he still has his flash to escape with his life. Look at the minimap, though. Team Liquid, they're trying to push on TSM's defenses, trying to salvage something from this huge play by Spica, by TSM, fighting them off of both big late-game neutral objectives. TSM will secure both, and they only lose the secondary turret there in the Team Liquid response. Spica with a huge play to keep Team Liquid in it, keep them in the race for finals. I thought it was gonna be so hard for him to get into this pit, and look at this. He walks up to the wall, he eats the Ash Arrow stun. He knows you just gotta spam taunt to try and get inside. He even gets triple knocked up by Ornn and Nautilus there. And then he taunts in and hits it. You kidding me? Plus he's gonna have his flash to get out alive. Biofrost also survives. He went in to get the knockup to buy the opening there. Team effort, getting their secret agent inside the pit, getting the steal for themselves, and now it's time to reap the rewards.
90 seconds on this map, TSM has both of these super-powered buffs under their control. They want a fight, and TL want the opposite at any cost. Mid lane inhib will fall here. TL willing to give that first inhib away, no contest. The question will become if TSM are able to force for end, because right now, Kobe, they're sticking around in the base. Unless you're going for end of game, there's no reason to still be here. And TSM want to maintain this presence, keeping Team Liquid back, seeing if maybe there's a chance to do anything with these buffs. 1 minute remaining.
All right, you got to keep up the pressure. You've got them both rolling for another two minion waves to work with. Doublelift going to try and push in on the side waves here. They've got the Elder Dragon execution to deal with these Team Liquid members. If any poke lands, that thing burns and it stings.
Nexus turret number one is gone. TSM stuck around long enough to get themselves an extra reward. Baron buff only alive for another 15 seconds. Elder's got about 30 left on that. Redemption coming through. Swirl Seed won't find anyone. Good sidesteps from TSM. Team Liquid continue to hold. Baron with 5 seconds left. The next minion wave won't have it for much longer. They'll get close to the turret, but they won't be able to tank too much. Ornn ulti coming through. Core JJ not going to hit the hook. Ornn ulti's not going to find anything. Team Liquid having to back themselves away. TSM may just have a win opportunity right here. Elder buff with only 8 seconds left. TSM have to back away. Team Liquid will maintain the defense.
Big defense here from Team Liquid. They focus on trying to clear these minion waves away, just seeing the last few seconds of these buffs time out on TSM. Team Liquid, they know they don't want to overcommit to that fight while TSM are wearing these buffs. They clear out the minions. They survive with a single Nexus turret left. But that is all you need to keep your game going.
Yup. There's no backdoor opportunity when you still have one of those turrets left alive, protecting that win condition, as it's a 3,000 gold difference between the teams 46 minutes in. Everybody's at 5 or 6 items. The gold difference doesn't mean a lot anymore. Lord Dominic's Regards now completed into Broken Blade after TSM regroups. That's his final item completion this game. The Elder spawning again in under 3 minutes. Baron in under 2, and we're going to get to see the same dance once more. TSM managing to steal that Baron away and then get the Elder after was such a huge moment for them. The last time these were both up, TL will be looking for a similar moment themselves here. But TSM are the ones in the more confident spot. They still have all 3 inhibitor turrets standing. All 3 inhibs obviously still so as well. It's the TL base that is vulnerable and could be potentially lost in its entirety from one misstep.
So close here for TSM going home. So close as well for Team Liquid to falter. The last finals that TSM were in were 2019 Spring Split, and that was their 2-3 loss at the hands of Team Liquid. Only Bjergsen and Broken Braid remain from that roster, but they want their vengeance, and they want to take it now. They're going to have to get side lanes pushing again. They've got super minions going down mid. They actually have Spica trailing. He went through jungle to clear out the camp. And even with just a Cinder Hulk, he's going to try and push up mid lane to get them there. Top lane will be the focus as they try and push ahead on TL.
I like this top side focus from TSM, knowing that they're going to have 45 seconds before that Elder Drake spawns. Core JJ nearly killed off here at the very start of the fight. Now he's going to be resurrected by Jensen. Team Liquid looking to mount some kind of a response, some kind of a defense, some kind of a kill on to Spica. But over the wall comes the damage. Tactical is down. Big kill coming through for TSM as Broken Blade is stuck in the back. He's alone 1v3, and he's going to be killed off now too. TL respond. Punch for punch. They've got themselves a kill advantage, but TSM with another punch right back. It's a 3v3 on the map, and Team Liquid are retreating back into the base.
The slugfest, all right, Flowers, and Bjergsen is throwing the haymakers. The Syndra stuns keep finding the kills. Bjergsen, scatter the weak, over the wall, gets tactical after they already drew out the Zillion ultimate on Core JJ there for the revive. TSM waiting around for a bush play here. They're trying to use the Baron as a little bit of bait. Team Liquid, they did find out that it's not getting started yet. They're still checking.
Jensen having to flash, but he dies! He has the chrono shift up and he dies. This could be it. This could be exactly what they needed to seal the deal and win the game. Jensen out of the picture for over 60 seconds. Swirl Seed goes through. Broxa has the ulti available if he looks to use it.
But Double
Lift goes for the last auto attack. He won't be able to get it. The stasis keeping Broxa alive. Double Lift is legendary. 9-1-7 on this Senna. Stand United coming in, keeping him protected yet again. Tactical has respawned. They've got to try to hold the base, but Impact is down. It is a 2v5 on the map. Tactical in trouble. TSM are taking us to game number 5. It's Silver Scrapes coming right at you. We're going the distance.
Is this real or has science gone too far, Flowers? It's a legendary Double Lift Senna. Carrying again, TSM forcing the Silver Scrapes, forcing another game 5 in playoffs.
I said I wanted 5 games today, and I am so glad that 5 games we are getting. Game 4, easily the closest one of the day so far, back and forth between both squads, and let's not mince words here. Spica's Baron Steel defined the end of that game. Being able to get the Baron into the Elder afterwards set TSM up for the success and control that gave them the rest of the game and the opportunity to play the game on their terms. That was the hero moment of the entire game 4.
That was such a fun game. Back and forth. So many critical plays from so many different members, and you could tell Team Liquid respected Bjergsen so much, Core JJ multiple times, trying to flash hook him, trying to spend 6 of their abilities to crowd control him, take him down. In key moments, Bjergsen also stepping up, hitting Syndra stuns. Double lift with his Senna carrying. Spica steals the Baron, gets them the two late game buffs. My goodness, the scripts are delivering, baby. We get game five here, the final deciding game. Who's going to be in finals? Team Liquid or TSM? Can't wait.
Well, the next line of my script says, hey, we got to head to a break right now. But once we're back, the State Farm Analyst Desk.